Greetings, BAC friends. I am honored to be here with my friend, Kyle Marshall. Pure coolness happening here. Thanks to Eleanor and Kristen for the invitation. Yay, me. Thanks to Katie for holding down the tech and to our ASL interpreter, Kat. So much love coming from all of you at BAC. Thanks so much. I am Charmaine Warren. I'm a light-skinned Jamaican. I am a non-disabled Black woman. Today, I give homage to the Native people by acknowledging that I live on the stolen land of the indigenous Lenape people, now known as Montclair, New Jersey. And I also acknowledge those who came before me and have toiled to make it possible for me to be present on this land. I have locks that fall to my shoulders. I'm wearing a yellow blouse and large wooden earrings with Adinkra symbols. I'm sitting on a green couch. Behind me are red and white curtains, a lamp, and a few of our cherished African and Jamaican artifacts. Turn it to you, Kyle.
Yes, thank you, Charmaine. Hey, everyone out there in cyberspace. Thank you, BAC and Katie and Eleanor for having me here in this talk. I'm very grateful. And Kat, back at the bottom, thank you for interpreting for us. My name is Kyle Marshall. I am a non-disabled, dark-skinned Black person. I am here in my home, which is on the land of Munsee Lenape, also known as Jersey City. I have an afro and dark skin. I'm wearing a gray shirt. I have a yellow back wall behind me, a little frame of a door, and a curtain to hide my closet.
I was going to ask you that, but I said, don't ask. You said it, though.
No, it's a little off center, and I've tried to make do with feeling like that, but it is a closet that I like to keep private. And I'm really happy to be here today and just to talk to everyone a little bit about Stellar.
Yeah. And I want to shout out Brad Learmonth, who sent a text to both myself and Kyle and asked us to be on our best behavior. That's not going to happen, Brad. Oh, well. But speaking of Brad, Kyle, you know, I didn't promise that I would tell you what I was going to ask you.
Yeah.
But I was thinking about not the first time we met, because that was 2014, but mm-hmm. I think. But later on, when you were about to do the movement research interview, is that what it was?
Yes.
Do you remember that?
Yes, we sat in your car and we had a conversation.
And we found out. You go ahead.
No, we found out a lot about each other and like dancing and Jamaica. We talked a lot about Jamaica. And dancing, you talked about your time with David Rousseau and doing work in that space, and talked a little bit about my history, and that was a while ago. That must have been 3 years ago, maybe 4 years ago. This was like a little bit, yeah, I mean, it's a little hard to believe. But yeah, it was a little bit before I started to think about my Jamaican body and choreography and practice, which is maybe a different space and conversation to talk about. But that was a great talk. I really appreciated that time we spent together.
Me too, sitting in the car outside the Joyce,
mm-hmm.
a little uncomfortable, but that was the only time we had.
Right.
Because lots of things were happening. This is pre-COVID.
Mm-hmm. It was.
I do want to say it's David Rousseau. Everybody says Rousseau, but David Rousseau.
Excuse me.
Oh, that's okay. But this is also the beginning of you saying, hey, I want to make a company and I want to make more dances and I want to give time to this.
Yeah.
Are you loving it? Loving this making dances and choreography thing?
I am. It's definitely comes with its ups and downs and challenges, especially coming out of this time of COVID. I spent a lot of time during the deep part of the pandemic, in isolation, making digital work, editing videos, learning how to edit videos, and improvising in my home, outdoors, in different kinds of spaces. And I, you know, coming into the Baryshnikov, it was the first kind of group project that I had worked on. I did a few other projects that were a bit more isolated, like working on film, but this was the first time that people were coming together to work on material for a presentation.
I think I'm interrupting you, but I want to ask you about film, because you said during COVID, you were in isolation and making film.
Yeah.
Did you like it? It was you making the film versus Stellar. You had other folks making the film.
Yeah, it was definitely a lot of learning in like editing and like understanding what could be possible. Like I'd never really explored film and video too much before this time, but during the pandemic, I might've made three or four video projects, and I fell in love with the potential of editing and like what could be possible on the film that's not possible live on stage. I found what the camera can hold had so much potential to like narrow in on the body and kind of look at detail in a way that's harder to do on stage when everyone's kind of in a set position and there's distance from the audience. I found the process in making Stellar to be quite different because I wasn't hands-on editing. I can be a bit of a control freak.
I was just gonna ask you that. So what was that like, sipping back and letting somebody else make the film?
It was relieving in some ways, and also like really—
Seriously?
Well, yeah, in some ways, because I didn't have to do all that labor. I mean, like it's a lot of labor to like edit and like get it together and stuff. Tatiana did an amazing job like going through the material and picking out things. I did realize that, like, you know, without having that control, there were certain things that I like was noticing in the work that, like, if I had more time, you know, of course, I would have shifted. And there's so many things that are not able to be shifted because it's film. It's like, even though it's virtual or it's like it's digital, it's still permanent. Like, there's a permanency to film and video that I found really interesting. And like, it doesn't quite feel the same permanent. It doesn't have the same kind of permanent nature when I'm working live. So that was really like interesting to feel. And also just the process of letting go, I feel like was really, really interesting in this process of making Stellar. I felt like I had to let go in the filming when we did it in March. I feel like I had to let go at a certain point with the editing, and like letting it go digitally has a different feeling of like a live performance. And so I had to kind of give myself the sensation of letting it go.
Okay, sensation.
Yeah. Well, I feel like, go ahead.
Let's name everybody, because we mentioned Tatiana. Well, I think there's an echo from me, I'm not sure. Mm. But name everybody.
Yeah.
In the film, the dance, and the support, and then we'll come back to talking a little bit more.
Yeah. So in Stellar was kind of started with the sound designer and I. The sound designer is Kwame Winfield. And I was joined by two other performers, Bree Breeden and Ariana Spite. And I was joined by the lighting designer, Mandy Ringer, who I've worked with a few times. And Ido Tastic kind of joined in the project with the makeup, and Malcolm X Betts kind of finished the collaboration with the costumes and the suits that we were wearing. And Tatiana did the filming and also the editing of the video.
Yay, Tatiana Tannenbaum and everybody. Did you all meet in Zoom? There is an echo and I think it's coming from me. I hope it goes away. But did you all have Zoom meetings?
We had a few.
Then you came together.
Yeah, so the project started with Zoom. So we had a few Zoom rehearsals, Zoom meetings, and we explored some of the physical ideas. And then we met in person in the studio a few times. And then we met with everyone all together at Baryshnikov for a week. And so the process was really focusing on improvisation and building scores of improvisation And so we kind of built those scores gradually, first virtually, then in person in the studio, and then thinking about space and the actual stage and all that for a week.
I just saw some dances. They were young, children dancing. Mm-hmm. And you could tell it was Zoom choreography. Mm. So coming together was wild, wasn't it?
It was. It was like the, I remember the last Zoom, we were like, can we just move on? Like, we were like ready. We were so ready to like be in person. And those first 3 days together were really like a wash. They were like such a flood of just energy and exchange and new collaborators and just kind of meeting new people. And so like the combination was really palatable. And I was really grateful to be back together in space. You know, it had been basically a year from the beginning of Stellar that I wasn't able to work in a space with other people. So it was really exciting to kind of come together again like that.
And yeah. You say the beginning of Stellar. That was a phone call to say, hey, you want to do something? I'm going to give you some money.
Right? Yeah, with Eleanor. Yeah.
Eleanor, of course.
Yeah, she called me in August. And she called me at a very, very low time for myself, I'll be quite honest. It was a time that I was really confronting a lot and kind of understanding how to move forward creatively. And I remember having the conversation with her and I was like, I don't know if I can do this. Like, I really had that feeling, especially like in August and after Black Lives and like all this, like in the middle of the pandemic, I was like, I don't see how this is possible. And she was really graceful with me and gave me some space to really think about it. And I was able to come back and understand how to move forward with this project. But it was definitely, it was like hard to vision. And I tend to be a future minded person. And no. I'm always either in the future or in the past. Me in the present is definitely work. but I didn't have it was hard for me to find a vision. It was hard for me to believe that I could do it. And slowly, step by step, I was able to understand a concept and kind of frame it. And also thinking about the project, I was like, well, there's so many variables going on. This might as well be something that I can use as a place of experimentation and trial and error. So I in the beginning of the project, I wanted it to be something that was different than how I was exploring before. And that reality really became true as we got closer to the performance and closer to the filming, and started working on the piece together. It continued to be a place of new questions and new ways of working and just kind of new ideas, kind of putting it into this project.
Do you remember when you said, okay, it's August, I can think about this now? And then you said, all right, I'm ready. And you started. Do you remember when that
I remember, I think she had given me a few days. I remember calling back and saying, I said, yes. And then a few weeks later, I was able to think about what could be possible. It was literally a yes on faith. Like, yes, yeah. I can do it. And maybe that goal was like a deadline was necessary for me. Mm-hmm. I'm someone that likes deadlines and goals. So the fall, it was probably like September. So if I had the conversation in August, it was probably around September, I started to think about what this project could be. I started to think about speculative fiction and space. And then jazz started to come into the mix in September. And I was like, oh, okay, this could be something that I was, that would be interesting to dive deeper into. And so that was like, and then the fall was just kind of dreaming the project, gathering source ideas, learning more about the free jazz era and the artists that were involved, learning a bit more about speculative fiction and some of the writers that were working in that genre. So it was a lot of new, just new ideas for me. And I was really happy to kind of explore these subjects of space and jazz and understanding how they're related and how my body connects into that.
Pretty groovy, yeah. Right?
It was very groovy. It was a lot of fun. A lot of music, great music to dance to, like just dancing. And I was in another apartment at one time, so we had a studio space. And just to dance in that space and just be in a state of improvisation, through working and the hustle and all that stuff before the COVID, I really lost like my voice in a certain way, my body in a certain way. I felt like I was dancing a lot out and not always, and dancing for work, but not necessarily dancing for my internal pleasure or internal reason. And so this pandemic in a way was helpful for me to just hear myself a bit more. And improvisation kind of became that place of germination, that place of spiritual lease, that place of like not knowing and like being okay with not knowing and not having a deadline or like the pressure of setting something. Wow. It was really relieving for me. And I think that kind of naturally led me into thinking about jazz and some of the philosophies that they were thinking about, some of those artists of those times.
So we said you played Alice Coltrane. Well,
yeah.
Katie played Alice Coltrane. Mm-hmm. And we confirmed that you love Alice Coltrane. Any other names?
Yeah, I mean, her partner, John Coltrane, is also someone that resonates with me. Sun Ra was a very big influence on the work. Sun Ra, both the sound and the imaging that was, and the costumes and the philosophy of Sun Ra. Kwame and I really talked a lot about that. And actually, Kwame shared with me a book of poetry by Sun Ra last December, so like December 2019. Uh-huh. Like that was maybe like, I knew of Sun Ra, but that was my first like, this is some serious stuff. And that was like December. So it wasn't until August, September that I started to actually like germinate about something in these ideas. And who else?
Improvisers? Oh, wait, no, go ahead. If there are more names.
I would say Pharoah Sanders. Albert Elier is another musicians those were connected. I was connected with.
And I was wondering if there were movers, improvisers that inspired you during this thinking time.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I did not focus on movers specifically in this process. I think I was mostly thinking about my own ways of moving. Mm-hmm. But the jazz dancing, I think is something interesting that like I have like not focused on so seriously, and like just the history of it, the people that are involved in it, I'd be really curious to learn a bit more about. I'm trying to think if there was any movers that, well, I think the idea of improvisation in performance is like a big thing that I feel like I haven't done so much in my work. It comes in a little bit, but I think Stellar was a big introduction of like, you know, what would it mean to work in a score and just kind of be in that kind of space? And what does it mean to set landmarks or ideas, but let the performer have that journey, not with the expectation of then deciding, but the expectation of like letting it be. And that was a new way of me watching movement and watching performers work with an idea, not watching to get something or to find something, but watching just to witness, I think was a different way of me interacting with building composition.
So this is a kind of a corny transition. What is that word? I don't know the word I'm looking for, but you have to leave a lot of stuff on the floor when you improvise, right? Because it happens and it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
Here's my corny transition. Lots of clips that you couldn't put in Stellar. A lot of things were left behind.
Mm-hmm.
What did you, I know you said it was hard and you had to step away from the editing, but what did you think about all those things that you had to leave behind, and what will happen to that, them?
Well, Stellar feels like it was the introduction of a lot of different ideas. For me, the improvisations were like introduced, but they feel like they continue as an idea in themselves. Some of them even have continued into like ideas of movement and choreography. So I feel like it's really open, because there were maybe improvisational scores that I was building that I didn't add into Stellar. But they did find a way in other works that I'm making presently. With the film footage, I feel like Tatiana did a really great job of selecting angles and images that really worked well. I think that, I don't know, like what's left on the editing room floor would you really seem to like build a collage out of? You know,
that would be kind of cool.
I would say why not, you know? I would say why not? Yeah, so
No, you go.
I was just gonna say that it feels like things, like choreographically things were left, but then picked up and maybe gathered for something else. Footage wise, I feel like she did a really good job of selecting the things that really were working the best. Yeah.
I forgot what I was gonna ask. I was gonna ask something very important and I lost it.
Back to you.
Oh, back on the stage. Do you see Stellar on stage? Because like you said, film versus performance, and you can change that 5, 6, 7, 8 right before you go on stage, but it's done, it's edited, there it is.
Right.
You see Stellar live?
I do. And I'm actually also planning to work on that in the fall. It brings up a lot of different questions though for me. I think that there's a lot of questions I have around, well, it's just different when you're watching something on stage. Like the body can only get so big. It can only get so close to you on a stage. And so there's certain limitations around what you can see. But there's also some more potential about seeing alignments in space. But I think there's different ways that I would have to kind of pull out an image or showcase a performer that is easier to do when we can narrow in on a performer on the lens. But I think there's ways spatially to kind of play with it. I think that I'd be curious what the whole work feels like to be seen live. I think there might be moments that might need to be shortened and kind of condensed, and moments that could be stretched out depending on what section we're in. And I do think that in the live version, there might, I think it would be supported by a few more elements of compositional work. I think with
people?
The compositional work.
Yeah, but
maybe
people.
Maybe people. I actually didn't think about adding more people. I'll think about that more.
Maybe more cameras? Maybe live and camera?
Oh, now you talking.
I know. I've got all kinds of ideas.
I know. I mean, we've been in this COVID time. We're like, oh, let's just keep it going. I mean, a live stream version, having multiple bodies in space could be really engaging. I have to kind of brainstorm that. I think that I love making dances for the live stage. And so for me, that really is my calling. I am curious how these other elements might come into the final work, the final stage version of the work.
And how do you feel now after watching, sitting back and watching what you created?
I feel good. I feel really proud. I'm really proud of all the collaborators and their work just involved. It was such a journey that involved a lot of trust, a lot of like quick decisions. You know, we were all kind of coming in this pandemic and just kind of in that space while we were trying to work together. So there was a lot that we were all kind of dealing with just to show up and be there. So I'm really grateful for everyone who was involved for that. And, you know, I think it's cool. Like it's like, it feels like something I've never made before. Yeah. And it felt like something that felt like a big risk that I was happy to take and to try out a lot of new ideas. So I'm really proud of it. I'm really proud of our work, and I'll let my criticisms like have a day off today.
Oh, yeah, today. Yeah. Would you change anything?
From the film?
Yeah.
I think that it would have been helpful to sit with some of the movement a bit more. Mm. I think the performers did an excellent job, but I also think we could have sank in a little bit, if we had a little bit more time, just kind of sank into the movement a little bit more, maybe looked at some other choices and kind of found out where things can go. I feel like we didn't get to that point where we got it to the place where we can film this and it can work, but we didn't get to the place where we started to question it again, you know, that kind of branching off into something else or, you know, considering. So I think that if I had a bit more time, I think there could have been more questions around theatricality, performativity, especially for the camera. I wish we had a bit more time to really have eyes in here or zoom in here, these kind of more specific moments that would have us connect more directly with the person watching on the, through the screen.
And what do you want the person watching on the screen to walk away with? Did I throw a curveball?
No. Okay. I feel like I would, I want a person watching to walk away with, they were in a world, they were outside of this world. I was really thinking about outer space, planets, stars. And so if, you know, we got this feeling of being outside of our world, I think that's really exciting. I think if people started to think about jazz and improvisation kind of rooted in Black arts traditions, that would be really exciting for me. And just kind of enjoying the ride a bit. I think for me that this piece was a journey, almost a spaceship. So I think that was something I would want to leave people with.
That's so cool, Kyle.
Yeah.
I'm feeling like you're moving towards Afrofuturism a little bit.
A little bit. I think this work was starting to push into that. I was spending a lot of time reading Octavia E. Butler and some of the poetry by Tracy K. Smith. I've always been a bit of a Afrofuture speculative fiction sci-fi fan. I was a Trekkie when I was a kid.
To me.
Oh yeah, deeply so. It was a family ritual every Friday night. Yeah. So for me, I stepping into my nerdy side by exploring these ideas and thinking about being in space. And then as I was making work, there's all this news about Mars and the SpaceX and all of these private space launches and all of these rovers going to Mars. And I'm like, oh, this is really happening. It's really happening. Cool. And I found that so interesting about the beginnings of this project, so interesting about speculative fiction, is that the writers create the images of what we think the future to be. We imagine, I don't know, flying cars in the future because someone wrote that down. You know, we have these phones on us that look like tricorders in Star Trek, you know? We have these Zoom conversations, and literally in the 80s, they're having TV shows where they're doing this. They're talking like this. And so we literally write the future that we intend and or the future that we want to intend or the future we think can happen. And I think that can be both in the positive and the negative, because then I think people just expect something to be in the future and we can really write that. And what I found really interesting about speculative fiction was the shifting of that towards a Black and Brown perspective, thinking about the diversity that's within us now and how that diversity continues into the future.
Cut us off. It's time.
Are you serious?
I swear to you. I know. Speaking of the future, y'all better watch Stellar because it's going to stop being in the future on the 21st. Did I say the right date, Eleanor? I hope I said the right date. 21st at 5 p.m. in the future, go watch it or else it's gone. 21st, 5 p.m. I'm going to say bye, but I'm going to pass it over to Kyle to really, really say bye. So cool that y'all joined us tonight.
Yes, thank you for joining. Thank you everyone at BAC for just having me in your space and supporting this project. Thank you, Katie and Eleanor and Kat. Thank you very much for having this conversation. I just want to say that KMC is working on another project. We're going to be performing a new work called Rise, which will be happening on live streaming June 25th. So you can check that out on the SHED website. And I just want to leave y'all with a quick quote from Octavia E. Butler. She said that all that you touch, you change. All that you change changes you. The only lasting truth is change. And I found that quote really helpful and inspiring for me during the process of making Stellar. So thank you very much, everyone, and have a great evening.